you're most concerned.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Senator Kaufman. Senator Wicker.
Thank you, and thank you, General, for being here and for your great work. I want to call to your attention an article which I'm sure you read in the June 12 New York Times. The headline is, Karzai is said to doubt West can defeat Taliban. And this article talks about the firing of two of President Karzai's top aides, Mr. Saleh and Mr. Atmar. They were said to have quit because Mr. Karzai made it clear he no longer considered them loyal. The article goes on to say that Mr. Karzai has lost faith in the Americans and NATO to prevail in Afghanistan. And one of the fired individuals, Mr. Saleh, has spoken at length, saying that President Karzai has been pressing to strike his own deal with the Taliban and the country's arch rival, Pakistan, the Taliban's longtime supporter. According to a former senior Afghan official, Mr. Karzai's maneuverings involve secret negotiations with the Taliban outside the purview of American and NATO officials. What do you say to that? I know Senator McCain was pressing on this yesterday. Is this happening at all in your judgment? And if it is it happening because the Americans are giving an uncertain sound about being a long-term strategic partner with Mr. Karzai and his government?
With respect to the very last point of that, Senator, having talked with President Karzai indeed about the meeting of July 2011, just as I started out today's session by explaining as precisely as I could what that means, that it's a message of urgency that went along with the huge additional message of commitment. Senator Lieberman reminded us of the words vital national interest used by the President with respect to Afghanistan. And again, July 2011, the point at which a process begins that is based on conditions to begin the responsible drawdown of the surge forces at a rate to be determined by those conditions at that time, based on advice and so forth, and also a process to begin transitioning some tasks to Afghan forces and officials. But I am not sure that I share the characterization of the headline, at least, about President Karzai's feelings. I base that on conversations with President Karzai, a number of them in the past month and a half or so, in Kabul from Kandahar in Washington.
How often do you speak?
Probably at least every couple of weeks. Again, it depends on the travel schedule. There's a period where we saw him several times in a period of just about 2 weeks, and then it may go a couple of weeks otherwise. But what we also do, of course, is at the very least, weekly video teleconferences that the Secretary of Defense, Undersecretary Chairman Mullen, and I do with General McChrystal, and then lots of other conversations with him in exchanges. And he certainly does not share that sense. He just accompanied President Karzai, for example, all day on Sunday when President Karzai flew to and from Kandahar and held the Shura Council down there. And as I mentioned earlier to the committee, I think it would be important that the committee see the talking points that he used for that, because this is a very clear statement by a president who is the commander-in-chief of his country, who is committing to taking the actions that are necessary and is rallying the people behind him, and who then at the end of this tells the ISAF commander, also U.S. Forces commander, you now have my full support for the conduct of these operations and the support of the people in this area. Now, with respect to meetings and so forth, President Karzai, of course, just hosted the National Consultative Jirga, Peace Jirga, which indeed addressed reconciliation and reintegration. I believe that we are aware of the meetings that he has and that his representatives have. He typically either includes our elements, or at the very least will back brief us. There, I would not characterize these as something that will culminate in reconciliation coming soon to a theater near us. Reconciliation, again, being high-level Taliban leaders coming in from, to accept the conditions that President Karzai has established, accepting the Constitution, laying down weapons, participating in the process, and so forth. On the other hand, there very clearly is scope for reintegration, and that is the term used for the reintegration into society of reconcilable members of the Taliban. Now we're talking low and mid-level, and there are a number of cases in which that is ongoing. I was just reading in the morning book this morning the case in Shindand out in the western part of the country. There's 80 or so that have come in with their hands up, put their weapons down, want to be reintegrated. And it's very important now, in fact, that the interim guidance that President Karzai has provided then is promulgated as formal guidance and does move forward to provide what our troopers need in terms of legal structures, if you will, and what the Afghan government elements need to work together to take advantage of those kinds of opportunities.
How likely is it, General, that secret negotiations could have been held with the Taliban outside the purview of American and NATO officials?
I think it's very unlikely, in part because we are told about what goes on, and we also have good insights, as they say, in the intelligence community into what's going on top of that, and the insights tend to correlate with what we're told.
Well, let me touch on one other thing in my remaining time, and that's interpreters. Of course, we need interpreters, but I'm told that in securing the services of talented linguists, they're being paid by the coalition anywhere from $50,000 to $200,000 a year, which is a considered by some a distortion of the Afghan economy. Are you concerned that we're taking some of the best human capital that could be used in the Afghan government, in Afghan civil society, in Afghan business, and taking them away so that they can be interpreters for the coalition?
The short answer is yes, Senator. In fact, Ambassador Holbrooke and I discussed this with President Karzai after we completed the two-day civil-military review of concept drill in Kabul about 2 months or so ago, and then went to back brief President Karzai. Very clearly, there is an issue. But I will, by the way, I don't think the salaries you quoted are correct for Afghans. I think those may be for U.S. citizens or Afghan Americans or something. But again, that we might want to verify for you. But the fact is, your point, which is more important, the substance of your point is exactly correct. What happens in some cases is the Afghan government, other countries, contributing nations, help build Afghan human capital by investing in them with education, and then we to go back and to work in Afghan ministries and so forth. And then in some cases, the NGOs hire them away, we hire them away, so we're competing with our own efforts, and we have to figure out how to come to grips with this. This is another of the tasks that this contracting task force is going to take a hard look at. In fact, the Afghan government really needs some kind of either law or regulations on this. You know, when the U.S. government sent me to graduate school, for example, I believe I had to give back 3 years for each year that I was in graduate school. And they need something like that. And President Karzai is actually keenly aware of it, as are we.
A plan to be announced later.
Correct.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Senator Wicker. Senator Akaka.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Let me add my welcome to Secretary Flournoy and General Petraeus. And I want to thank each of you